8th, 2008, and we are here in Cleveland, Ohio with Robert McMillan. Good morning, Mr. McMillan.
Hi, good morning.
I am so thrilled to have you share your story with us, and I wanted to start from the beginning, so I was hoping that you would tell us your date of birth, place of birth, and that era of your life before coming to, and then coming into Cleveland. We'll segue in there.
Right now?
Yes.
Here we go. Okay. I'm Bob, of course, to most people. Okay.
Your full name?
McMillan.
Robert?
Robert F. McMillan.
What's the F stand for?
F stands for my middle name, which actually was given to me by a friend of the family in Bellevue, Pennsylvania, which is a suburb of Pittsburgh. Okay. My mother at that time had three little boys. I was in the middle of the three, second born. And this woman had three sons of her own. And each one of them had its own name. And I think they were Washington or Abercrombies were their names in Bellevue, Pennsylvania. And the middle of her sons took to me as the middle of the McMillans. And gave me my second name, which was Franklin. And so when I was born on the birth certificate, I think it's on the birth certificate, as Robert Franklin McMillan. But when I got to school, I figured that was a little bit long, so I shortened it to Frank.
Oh, okay.
And it's been Frank ever since.
Okay.
All right, now.
Okay.
Date, October 4th, 1918. That's the end of World War I.
Wow.
1918, okay. Mm-hmm. And which makes me today, a little math will figure it out, but you know I'm getting up there, yeah. Okay. All right, now, I came to Cleveland in 1927.
So you were born in Pittsburgh?
Born in Pittsburgh. Not in that house, but nearby.
Okay.
My older brother corrected me on it once before. Mm-hmm. Bellevue was, use a colloquial expression, in a black area when I was born. Mm-hmm. It is now one of the, that part of Bellevue was all black. Now that part of Bellevue is high tone, where by this year is a place for notables to be. Mm-hmm. And I was surprised. Usually they go the other way and run down. I go back now and I hardly recognize the place because improvements and they use these old houses as trophy houses, you know. But it's nice,
wow.
Real nice, and it's nice to go back too. Mm-hmm. And that's another story. But anyway, I love it. And I remembered the address in 602 Madison Avenue, et cetera, et cetera.
Okay.
From the youngster. And Franklin, who is my mentor or whatever, they're all gone now. Because I was a little, very little boy there. Okay, we came to Cleveland. Now, my mother was separated from my father at that time, and she was the mother of three boys.
Mm-hmm.
Burrheads, we called them back then, you know. my dad was a businessman.
Mm-hmm.
For black businessmen back at that time, and he was always on the road and sending money back. And she was having a tough time. Every time I see a woman going down the street with two or three kids, I say, that's my mother and her three little burrheads, you know?
Yeah.
And the stepstone. We're exactly 3 years apart within a month.
No kidding.
You get one's age, you got all the rest of them.
No kidding.
Uh-huh. So, I think. The absence from having an absentee father, it's not like today when they just take off. He was actually out trying to make money.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'll take a small aside. My dad's a graduate of Tuskegee.
Oh.
That's where he went to school. And that's another whole story how he got there. But he adopted the name McMillan from his mentor, who was a white man from the area, nearby area, who picked my dad up on the side of the road, sitting on a rock, trying to read a newspaper upside down.
Oh.
you see.
Oh.
And so that started a friendship. And so he, the man took him home with him, turned him over to his wife. You might got to have a houseboat or something. I guess back then you could do that, you know. You got big families all. He's got brothers and sisters he never knew of, because he never went back to his original home. I'm getting too far off now.
No, that's good.
But anyway, that takes why my mother had the three boys.
Mm-hmm.
And so she came to Cleveland with the three boys because she and my dad had agreed at that time to get a divorce.
Mm-hmm.
She brought them in. We got off the Pennsylvania Railroad Station right down there, 55th and Euclid. And she took them out to Scoville Avenue in Cleveland, which is now Community College Avenue. And because he, at that time, was an undertaker.
Your father?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And he, here we go again.
Mm-hmm.
You better tell me, because I didn't even feel it creeping down.
That's good.
And so it was People's Undertaking on Scoville Avenue, and I remember the address was 3212 Scoville, which, of course, would put it pretty close to 30th Street, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And we moved in with him. She turned the three boys over to my dad. And they were like buddy buddies and all that, you know, friends. And she went to live at the Phyllis Wheatley on Cedar, I believe it is.
Okay, yes. Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. And so that's how we all started out. He had the three boys, plus he had another one from another association, Louise, which we always call sister, because we were all very young. And we lived in the funeral parlor right on 3212 Scoville, and we helped with the funerals. Back then, they didn't have radios or televisions or whatnot, or taped in music. So they had record players distributed along in the funeral home. Here, nearer my God to thee, et cetera, et cetera. And the boys with eton collars and ties with little blazers on would stand beside the phonograph and wind it when it begins to wear down. When the words get slurred a little bit, then you know it's time to wind it, you know?
I can see that picture, yes.
So he had to stand right by there, and he says, no monkey business, you know. And so, and then we'd wind it and stand, and the regular service would go on, you see. But my dad was known throughout the area as being sympathetic with his mourners. And especially when it comes to finance, because nobody had any money back then. And on Scoville Avenue, I can remember as a kid, every other store was selling records, and loudspeakers were broadcasting out on the street. And Scoville Avenue reminds you of up in Harlem in New York, or in Washington, down on 7th Street, near T or something like that, where it's all black. It has its own system of living.
Yeah.
They walk the streets. Not many cars out there then. Walked the streets and drinking, saying, buying and eating watermelon and everything that black folks are supposed to do. Okay. So, anyway, so. That's my memory of the early childhood. I went to Case Woodland School, elementary school, uh-huh. Up on Woodland Avenue. I remember a library there, but I can't think of the name. But I did know if we wanted to take a long walk, we'd walk from the funeral parlor at 30th Street up Woodland Avenue to 55th.
Wow.
That was big time.
Wow.
Now, 55th and Central was also big time. And the three of us would walk, and my dad wasn't afraid of us getting lost, and he'd just walk straight up and just looking at the sights, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Early Cleveland was something, just something else. He had funeral cars, open-top funeral cars. If the top could go up, if bad weather, and it seats about six. You've seen pictures of people sitting up in these old cop fashion cars.
Mm-hmm.
You can see them from the waist up, mm-hmm. You see. And big wheels on it and whatnot, and a driver, you know. And that would be the funeral procession, you know.
Wow. Mm-hmm. That's
something. Uh-huh. But my dad, a very popular neighbor and a very good friend, Mr. Wills, at that time, was another undertaker, and they all belonged to, like, an undertaker's association.
I don't believe you told me your dad's name.
James.
James McMillan.
My older brother is he didn't want junior, so he's a James too. Well, was, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's where James McMillan. And there's a big story there, too. We might touch on it later on about his days at Tuskegee.
Okay.
In fact, he's a lot. He gave the school itself that he went back down years ago and had a meeting with the old timers there. Very few people remembered much about him as a student. But at that time, they bought electricity from the city of Tuskegee, and he helped them build a unit to manufacture their own.
Mm-hmm.
And whether that was still there or not, I don't know.
Wow.
Anyway, back to Cleveland.
Mm-hmm.
So that was my early beginnings, and I had all good memories from back then. We played a lot. My dad used a brick garage in the back of the house for his morgue. And as they bring bodies in for preparation for funeral, there's work in the morgue to prepare the body for the funeral.
And the name of your father's funeral business again?
People's Undertaking.
People's Undertaking.
I imagine somewhere down in the archive of old Cleveland, it'll be in their phone books or in their ads mm-hmm. in the paper or something like that. I never took the trouble to dig it out, you know. But nice big house, a lot of room upstairs.
Did he work there until he died?
No. That was just the beginning of his many exploits, you know. He ended up as a coal mine owner in West Virginia later on. That's when the McMillan family had a couple of dollars they could rub against each other. And he began to send money to our livelihood.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now I could go on there, but now I start to grow up, going to different schools as we moved out of that neighborhood into others and whatnot. And it ended up with my mother taking us from Bellevue, Pennsylvania to Cleveland. But that was after we stayed for a while in Washington, D.C., but that can come a little bit later on. That's another whole chapter in itself, because I love Washington, too.
So growing up as a child, mm-hmm. when you were very young,
yeah.
you moved to Cleveland first?
No, after.
Oh, you went to Washington, D.C., and then to Cleveland.
That's right. Uh-huh.
And because then she brought you to your dad in Cleveland.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
And then, would you say, how old were you when you got to Cleveland?
Nine.
Nine.
About nine. Mm-hmm. I think if you add up, if my math is right, it should put me where I am today.
Okay.
I didn't sometimes wonder whether I got here in 1929 and I was 7 years old, or I got here in 1927 and I was 9 years old.
Okay.
So let's leave it with the nine.
Yeah, that's good enough. That's close enough.
It's close enough, right.
And then so then after you moved out of the central area, where did you move in Cleveland?
Now my mother and my dad had a little talk about the three boys as being a burden on my stepmother,
mm-hmm.
his new second in command, you know.
Mm-hmm.
My older brother, 3 years older than me, would be 12 when he got here. So he always used a three multiplier, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And she was beginning to find out about girls and stuff, and my mother wasn't prepared to deal with his new. So she thought my dad would be a better thing for him.
Mm-hmm.
And my younger brother was 3 years younger than myself, so my mother thought it would be easier for him to have both the oldest and the youngest, and she'd keep the middle. Because, see, we were kind of buddies.
Okay.
I was a mother's boy, you know.
Okay.
And so it worked out fine.
Okay.
And then we lived at 71st and Cedar.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. 71-11, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. And not too far from the corner, but there was a gas station between our building and the corner.
Okay.
So, and I went to Gidding School up 71st Street.
Mm-hmm.
And I always got decent grades, but I was always afraid to get good grades because that would kind of separate you from the gang or the people. You know.
Even back then, there was
back
they
then,
had that mentality.
Part of that slave mentality, you know.
Mm-hmm. Don't be too white.
Yeah, you have to go with the flow.
Mm-hmm.
You see, if you want to have friends and be liked among your peers, you have to kind of fit in.
Okay.
You see? And it's okay to make the merit roll or something like that, or outstanding or whatnot, but I never was an outstanding student because I tried not to be. you see. And I always felt equal to my peers, but I didn't even know who my peers were, you see, back then. You know, anyway. So school was easy, and I was well behaved. I've got pushed around a little bit, but teachers can't hit students anymore. But I've had my share of that. That's the Washington section. We may get in or we may not on this trip around. Now,
okay.
Anyway.
Okay.
But I had a nice childhood. I always had a nice personality. I got around with everybody. I didn't mind smiling. It was a lot. I was criticized because I smiled too much. You know?
Really?
Yeah, you don't do that in the ghetto, you know. you just don't do that. That's a sign of weakness.
Oh.
So, anyway.
Okay.
But I always had fun.
Uh-huh.
You see, like pretty girls.
Like pretty girls.
Yeah, and it was nice. But my mother got sick. Tuberculosis was very prevalent back when I was 12 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And she had tuberculosis. She spent some time out in, we had a tuberculosis hospital out here in Warrensville somewhere. Mm-hmm. Back then, and then if you had back then that snatcher off the street, so you might contaminate the neighborhood where,
mm-hmm.
and they keep you there until you're safe to get back into the mm-hmm. mainstream. And then she had an appendix operation at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
Between the two, she couldn't make it. And since we were buddies, and a lot of times being buddies, she would take me out of school because there's a good movie she wanted to see downtown.
No kidding.
I remember Simba. Oh. Simba is an African name for a lion.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, like the Lion King
right.
today.
Right.
And she liked it and she thought I'd learn more in the movie in the school, so she arranged to take me out of school. And I thought that was the best thing a mother could ever do.
Mm.
Take me out of school. Of all places, that's like jail, you know.
and take you to a movie.
Yeah. Well. Yeah, that was something. And we often talk about it. The guy was our favorite, yeah. And back then, you didn't go to Kresge's or whatever, buy tools. You made your own.
Mm-hmm.
And I was handy with tools. So she brought me her own little toolbox with a saw and a hammer and screwdriver and stuff like that. And I'd take shoeboxes and make a train out of them. See, like women like shoes, you know. I just hook the halves of the shoebox up, and I got a freight car, you know, with a paper
wow.
cutter, and just pull the leader when they could walk around the house.
Mm-hmm.
And she liked to sit up and then we'd play train, you know. It was nice. Anyway, she died, and that starts another whole area. My dad lived in Mount Pleasant, which was a real nice place to live at that time, and. He was in real estate at that time, too. And now he's got two boys and a girl. And now they live with my mother down on Cedar. And when she died, they got together and decided I would have to go live with the other boys. And that's how he ended up in Mount Pleasant.
Okay.
You see?
Where did you live in Mount Pleasant?
126th Street.
Okay.
I can't remember the address, but it was between Abel and Metcalf.
Okay.
Right.
I know exactly where it is.
Okay, then. Uh-huh, and I went to Audubon. My first one went to Alexander Hamilton. And then at that time, we had begun to move around in Mount Pleasant. What you would do then, you get a house, and remember, here's something to remember too. At that time, houses were selling from anywhere from $3,500 to about $5,000. Now, mostly, the owners of the property in Mount Pleasant were not blacks.
Yeah, that Kleenex on your sleeve.
What's that?
Kleenex on your sleeve.
Oh, here? Yeah. Thanks for reminding me. The housing in the total Mount Pleasant was mostly owned by a few blacks and mostly all white folks, and white folks of another race, which doesn't matter right now. And my dad did well among them because he was in real estate at the time. So, whenever a house became vacant, and it was cheaper for him to move in because he knew the owner, we'd move in.
Oh.
See? And either get reduced rent mm-hmm. or none at all.
Mm.
See? Then we'd fix up the house while I was in there. It helps the landlord. So when we moved in, he could rent it easier. See? So then my dad taught us all of the things necessary to keep my house together. Plumbing, wiring, digging, everything we could do. See, and my dad abhorred manual labor, so but he had an overall suit that would cover up, and he wouldn't change clothes. He'd just take his suit coat off, because all men wore suit and ties. Men didn't have sport clothes back then mm-hmm. at all. Mm-hmm. Either you had if you had a shirt on, either the shirt had the tie to go with it or not. So he always wore a white shirt every day, had a briefcase. By the time he had sandwiches in there when he'd be walking around, or something to nibble on, or extra white shirt, you see. Mm-hmm. And so when we'd go down in the basement to start walking, he'd take his shirt and tie off, leave his toilet and get inside of his coverall thing, and he didn't zip the button up all the way up here and go to work down at the basement. You see?
Taught you everything.
And then the boys were down handing him tools and helping him strip pipes, thread pipes, pipes would break from the cold weather, stuff like that. We did all that in somebody else's house. But the man, well, we didn't pay any rent. So he and the owner got together. Mm-hmm. So we moved a lot. At the time, I lived close to 130th Street and I went to Alexander Hamilton. Mm-hmm. But we had moved back down into about 126th Street, or no, 116th or 7th, near 116th Street, which divided our neighborhood at Woodhill Park.
Okay.
You see. Mm-hmm. So, anyway. I went to Alexander Hamilton and then transferred to Audubon. Audubon was Slavic.
Oh.
Totally. They played soccer. I never heard of soccer before. So I went out to the soccer team and I made the team. I played soccer with them. But then John Adams didn't have soccer. So when I graduated, I gave up. I was too light for football. So, but I ran on the track team with John Adam. Hmm. Well, in the meantime, my brothers and Louise all went to the same schools. All went to John Adams, all finished with John Adams. And I'm moving right along now. I did very well at John Adams. And I learned, at that time I was into mechanical drawing. The official word is drafting.
Mm-hmm. How many blacks were in John Adams then?
Not very many. By numbers, it would be maybe 45 or 50. Mm-hmm. See, but in Audubon, it was about 7 or 8.
Was it hard? Because, you know, you hear Brown versus Board of Education, and that was a big push to integrate schools, but you were already in it. You were already integrating schools.
Right. At John and Audubon.
Right. Did they treat you fairly?
Yeah, as far as fair goes. You see, blacks back when I was a kid knew their place. Mm-hmm. The line was drawn clearly that this is your boundary. Mm-hmm. The 30th Street at that time was like a boundary for downtown and outtown. Mm-hmm. Carnegie was another boundary. See, now you blacks could live anywhere west of Carnegie and south of 30th Street.
But then now you're in Mount Pleasant, though, so you've come out of that boundary to Mount Pleasant.
Well, I came out of the central area, mm-hmm. which would be Woodland and 30th Street and down there, up to 71st Street, and that were blacks. All along Cedar Avenue from 55th Street on up were all black. I lived on 80th Street before I went to service. Nice houses. Lawyers and doctors lived on that street.
And Cedar Avenue. Describe Cedar Avenue for me in those days.
Cedar was a prominent... Okay. Pardon me again. Cedar Avenue was prominent for people of notoriety. Not notoriety, because of the racketeers and the numbers and stuff that were very prevalent back in the 40s, early 40s or late 30s. And then housing was plentiful. 79th Street, on up 93rd, on up to about 105th Street, all black. Back over in the rural mirror on the other side, 105th Street, all black, apartment houses and everything, and concentrated. But as you go towards the lake, you get to Carnegie, it stops. Mm-hmm. on this side of Carnegie, not the other side. Mm-hmm. In other words, yeah. When I lived on Cedar, I used to go out in the backyard, and they had a big wooden fence with missing planks, and all the white kids on the other side of the fence, and we'd come to the fence and integrate.
And talk.
Yeah. Now, you don't step through that hole in the fence to get and play with them, or they don't get to step through the hole in the fence and come over and play on us.
You play through the fence.
We play through the fence, right.
Isn't that something?
Uh-huh. And all on the other side of that fence, which were apartment houses with all white in it, and Carnegie, then on the other side of Carnegie, then you're going towards Euclid, and you're way out of your area until you got over to like Huff or something like that, then it's black startup again.
Oh.
And then that was known as the Gold Coast on the other side of Superior.
Okay.
You're going that way, towards the lake.
Yes.
All that was way. You
know. I remember the Gold Coast, so that was the Glenville area.
Glenville area, right. That's
called the Gold Coast.
That's called the Gold Coast. Mm-hmm.
Tell me when you come in, I hear stories about Cedar Avenue. Tell me, were there a lot of businesses up and down Cedar?
Mostly nightclubs and bars. Mm-hmm. One bowling alley that I can remember.
Pool hall.
Pool rooms, oh yeah, all that. And
pool rooms were respectable places to go in those days.
Cedar Gardens was a review, you know, the girls dancing and stuff like that, band playing. But I never had enough money to go to Cedar Gardens. That was people with the dollar bills and all that sort of stuff, you know. But I used to go up there. Back then, in order to socialize, you have to get in with the people that you want to socialize with.
Right.
So I had to learn how to be tough and get into fights and stuff like that, you know. And then, what used to burn me up, I'd like to have a girlfriend. I'd like to take her up to one of the bars. And they had a lot of them, one right after the other, up in the Cedar and 193rd, and all up in there, all bar, one right after the Chauffeur's Club and all that. But then the white folks, but it belonged to the white folks on weekends, Friday night and Saturday night. You can't get a seat in the bar because all the white people come in and get the seats. Now, if you were sitting with your girlfriend at a bar in one of those bars up on Cedar Avenue, and the bartender would ask you to move because there's a white couple just come in and they'd like to have those seats.
Wow.
Yeah. Or, if you got up and went to the bathroom, this guy would sit his wife down where you were, you come back, you want your seat, and the bartender would side with them. Or she's sitting there now, why ask her to move? It's not our fault, you had to go to the bathroom, yeah. Well, you know. But now, you know what I'm saying.
So you let it go.
Yeah, right. Or, if you had your brothers, you get a fight. See, you had your boys, you know.
Now,
if you get into a fight, then they don't want you in there next time. Because
yeah.
You're a troublemaker.
Yeah.
You see. But I've been put out more than one bar. Big mouth, you know. I was here first and all that. I'm telling you the truth. I had my little, my side, you know. I hit you in a minute.
Would you?
Oh, yeah. It hurts too.
Oh my goodness! Now tell me about John Adams, and you were in the mechanical drawing, drafting.
Oh, yeah. Okay, now we got mileposts along the way. I was a foreman of the class, top student. See, and then John Adams encouraged me to come out a little bit. If I want to go on a roll, go on and get it.
Okay.
See, they liked it. And the ribbons you get with it, you know, all that. Yes. And I got stuff at home, you know. So, as a foreman of the class, a lot of my work was taken downtown and put in the Board of Education in the glass cases down there.
Okay.
They were so pretty and nice. And so then the teacher liked me because I had to help him out. Mm-hmm. So a lot of kids couldn't print well, couldn't draw a straight line or didn't know the difference between a thick line and a thin line and all that sort of stuff. And I did. I loved it. But now, as we began to get to the 12th grade, and I was still into that, different companies would send their recruiters down to the school to see possible draftsman.
Oh.
But they wouldn't come to see me.
Oh. They wouldn't come to see you.
No. So one day, Thompson Products, I named some of the company, would send them in. And they go to the teacher, and the teacher would talk them over to this kid and his board. And I got my big one here, and I got something on there. I'm building a house or something, or a piece of machinery. And so one day, I told him, I says, how come they never come and interview me? I had, way in the back of my mind, I had an idea, but I didn't want to believe that. Mm-hmm. So I figured my draftsmanship would carry me anywhere I wanted to go. Mm-hmm. It's a universal trade.
Mm-hmm.
If you're a good draftsman, you're in command. You don't make any money, but you're in command.
Mm-hmm.
So then he pulled me aside one day and he said, hey, let's go in his office and shut the door and let's have a little talk. Mm-hmm. We're okay here?
Mm-hmm.
All right. He said, Robert, they're not going to come to your table, to your board. I said, he said, now, this, you and I have a little heart-to-heart talk here. I'm white and you're black. All of these men that come in here are from white companies who do not hire black draftsmen.
Wow.
He said, that's a fact.
How'd you feel?
About that big, you know. And so he says, they just don't hire them. And I said, well, you mean I'm doing all this work and I can't get a job? He said, that's the hard part. But, he said, you got skills. And they're going to show up somewhere else one of these days, mark my word.
Wow.
And they're going to show up one of these days in other things. Don't worry about this. You're doing a very good job here. Everybody knows you downtown and everything. They got your drawings downtown and everything. But nobody would tell you this, but I think I should.
Isn't it nice?
He said, but don't let it bother you. See, this is, he told me, this is the beginning of great things for you in the future, I see, so don't worry about it. You just keep up doing what you're doing, and whatever you do as good as you do this, you'll never have a problem doing anything.
So he was very encouraging.
Somebody better encourage you, you know.
Yeah.
So I says, okay. So then I graduated. Now let's see how that go. Now I was supposed to graduate in 1936, and I finished in February 37. And I did that to stay in school longer because there was no jobs ahead. But other people tell me, no, you flunked something, that's why they kept you. I said, well, either way you look at it, I graduated February 37.
Yeah.
But I'm in the class of 36.
Okay.
That settles that.
Right.
I don't want to hear your version.
Okay.
I didn't flunk nothing.
Well, yeah, you get hit in the mouth.
Right. But see, we don't do that. Not my dad. No, my dad was pretty sharp too, you know. At home, he'd help you with your homework. I don't care what it was.
Okay.
Yeah. And around the dining room table. And pass him before you take it to school and give it to the teacher. You see. Okay, let me pause here if I can. How are we doing on your...
You know, Mr. McMillan, we paused for just a minute, but you were telling us about your skills and your teacher. But I wanted to put a pin in that thought, and I want to go back to your parents a little bit.
Okay.
Because we want the family to get a sense of who everybody was in your family.
Okay.
So tell us a little bit about your dad and his background.
Okay. Let's start where my dad would start. he was sitting on the side of a road on a rock trying to read a newspaper upside down, okay? And a guy comes by on a horse and he said, hey, what are you doing over there? My dad says, nothing. He said, who are you? He said, my name is James. He said, where are you from, James? He said, down the road. We're down the road, you see. He said, well, back, I've been walking all morning, you know, I'm tired. And I was just, saw this piece of paper, guys, okay. So I get on the horse and sat down beside him and started talking. And so he said, what else is your name? He said, James. What else is your name?
What's your name?
James. He said, I don't know. I said, what town are you from? He said, I don't know. You got brothers and sisters? Yeah, he's got a lot of them. And where are they? He said, back where I came from. He said, well, did you leave or are you just taking a walk? He said, I guess, leaving or walking. And so he says, do you have a home? He said, yeah, back there, but there's nothing back there. And so you're just out. He says, well, I'll tell you what. Why don't you come on home with me? Have you had any lunch? He says, no, sir. You know, he said, come on, get up on the horse. He got to take him on. And introduced him to his wife. And he says, he's mannerable and he's nice. And it seems he has nice manners and everything. And can you use him around the house? She says, sure. He became houseboy. No education at all at his age, whatever it was, 8 or 9 or something. He took him to Tuskegee and put him in school.
This white man did?
Yeah. And his name was McMillan.
Ah.
You see? And he enrolled him in school as James McMillan.
Oh.
It gave him his name.
Tuskegee was built at that time, and it was an all-black school started by Carter G. Woodson.
Back to school, I don't want to say the wrong thing. I don't know that much history about the school and Booker T. Washington and all that. I should.
I said Carter. Yeah.
Booker T. Washington.
Booker T. Washington.
Uh-huh. And so he started school and finished there. And they taught the boys industrial education, how to run a machine.
Yes.
Good aside, there's a picture of back when I was going to Warner and Sweetie, taken in Tuskegee, running, a bunch of boys in their machine shop, running one of Warner and Sweetie's machines.
Wow.
Yeah.
We're going to come back to that because you worked at Warner and Sweetie.
Right, I was there.
But we want to finish hearing about your dad.
I looked on that picture for my dad. Mm-hmm. And I saw a bunch of little Broadway running up the Warner and Swayze machine. I know the Warner and Swayze machine when I see one, but none of the kids in that school. But they had that in their archives about showing one of their machines being in Tuskegee University at that time with the black kids running that machine.
Isn't that something?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so your father learned how to read from?
School.
School. And the lady in the house?
Taught him manners and all that sort of stuff.
I see.
Yeah. And he grew up there in the house. Starting out as a houseboy and now part of the family. And so when
his name was
James.
The people that had him, I mean that took care of him was McMillan's, right?
Right. That's what
he took on their last name.
He took on their last name, right. Because when he put him in school, he had to have a last name. They didn't know it. Mm-hmm. He didn't know it. He said, look, use mine. And that started it.
Isn't that so?
No. My older son doesn't believe that. Who cares what he thinks, you know. But anyway.
Your son, Bob, doesn't believe this?
No, Bob said, Dad, that's too easy. I said, well, what else you got? He said, none. I said, look, well, put it this way. This is 2008. My two brothers have passed. I'm the authority.
That's right. And who would know? And that's why we're doing this tape.
There you go.
Because you provide the link.
So when I tell you that,
it's true. Yes. Tell us about your mother. She met your dad in the South?
No. Dad finished school. Mm-hmm. And he went to work for Atlanta Life Insurance Company in Atlanta.
Oh.
You see? And she worked for them.
Oh.
That's it. Something like that. And they fell in love and all that sort of stuff. And she had a brother from that area. I'm going to get this right now. Oh, then they moved from Atlanta to Pittsburgh.
Mm-hmm.
My dad and mother. My oldest son, my oldest brother was born in Atlanta, where they were.
Okay.
Then they moved to Pittsburgh, up north.
Mm-hmm.
And she wrote her brother, William, a letter saying, they're hiring like crazy up here. Why don't you come on up here and get a job? Because down Atlanta was nothing for him to do.
Okay.
He went up there, and he and my dad got buddy, and my dad found something for him to do, and he eventually ended up in the post office.
Okay.
And back then they had railway mail.
They had what?
Railway mail. In other words, they didn't have airplanes back then. So if you wanted your letter to get from here to Chicago in a hurry, you sent it railway mail.
As opposed to
trucks or horses or whatever else you got up there.
Oh.
And then railway men were high-tone postmen.
High-tone meaning light-skinned?
No. Higher echelon.
Oh, high-tone means higher echelon.
Right. In other words, they carried guns even because, see, they were still robbing trains back then. You think I'm lying, that's right, with a badge. Because he's a railway postman.
Well, the Brinks people carry guns.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. And so then Uncle Buddy, that was our uncle, William Trent.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, and something else about Uncle Bill. In World War II, he got drafted and he joined the cavalry.
That was in World War II.
World War I.
Okay.
I beg your pardon. Railway I. He joined the cavalry, and we got pictures somewhere of him and his horses.
No kidding.
Mm-hmm. And he was one of the first black lieutenants that anybody ever heard of. And
I didn't think the military was integrated.
This is history. And he was a lieutenant. And I remember that since I was a little kid. I had to go look up the word to see what the hell it meant. But that was a rank, you know. So anyway. So then that's how the Vicksburg came in, mm-hmm. You see. So now the whole family, they're Marshalls. Mother's name was Marshall.
Okay.
So he was Bill Marshall, William Marshall.
Mm-hmm.
And then they married into McMillan's.
Where was your mother born?
I don't know. I would have to guess. If I knew, I can't recall now.
Okay.
But she's probably in Atlanta. She's from that area.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And she was a pretty girl. Pretty. About 110 pounds or something. Bow-legged, like me. Uh-huh. And loved to dance and party.
Did she?
And my dad was a big-time businessman, you know.
Uh-huh.
He didn't drink or smoke ever.
Uh-huh.
And everything was business. And we were growing up as teenagers, we started hiding whiskey around the house. You see? Because if he saw it, he would take it.
And pour it out.
Do something with it. Sure wouldn't drink it.
Wow. That's so nice to hear those family stories and see how it all comes in together.
Back in old radios, you know, they made a console like you got sitting over there. Well, back where the speaker is, there's nothing back there but room for whiskey.
That's where it was.
That's where we kept it. Mm-hmm. Well, there were three of us. We were like the three
musketeers,
and
the three got into all kinds of things.
Oh, got into all kinds of things. Yeah.
Good memories.
Good memories. Yeah.
I want to ask you before we go back to school, because we are going to come back there. Uh-huh. But you talked about. On Cedar, there were racketeers and numbers people.
Oh, yes.
Tell me about that. What does that mean, numbers people?
Okay, back then, we got a lottery now today.
Mm-hmm.
That was predicted many, many, many years ago. Eventually, it'll be legal. But back then, it wasn't.
Uh-huh.
You see? Mm-hmm. And it had two types of lottery. One was a three-digit number,
Clear. And
the other was a series of double numbers.
Mm-hmm.
One was, I can't think of its name.
Policy.
Policy, right. You can either buy 22, 44,
444,
and any of those appeared on there, you get paid. I never paid it. And the three-digit thing, they got that from the newspaper.
Right.
You go to the newspaper.
Stock market,
and one of those in a long list of like a million or a billion, one of those three-digit numbers, they said will be their number for today, whatever come out. It'd be under 10, you know.
It came out of stocks and bonds.
Stocks and bonds, right. Mm-hmm. And so now, the Italians did the lotteries, or the clearinghouse, or what do you call it? Right?
Uh-huh. And who did the policy?
They couldn't enter and operate in a black neighborhood because it was all black. So they got some of the black entrepreneurs to do it for them. Mm-hmm. So when the black folks got into the lottery, that kind of money that they were handling was just out of sight. They started buying Cadillacs like crazy. I mean, Cadillac, it had to be in numbers, man, because don't know why I'm driving a Cadillac in a big neighborhood, but a clearinghouse, man.
Oh.
Right, yeah, and then he started building houses, and he tried to get a shaker, and shaker wouldn't let him go. As close as they were, up Scottsdale, somewhere around there, I can't remember the street now, but
Bartlett.
There's a Bartlett, there's a great big house. That's as close as he could get to shaker with his house. This guy built, and it's like a Fort Knox.
I know.
Walls 3 feet thick.
Really? Was it the Gray family?
I can't remember.
Okay.
That part. All right. I wasn't into that kind of stuff.
Right, right.
They say, okay. Their money? Okay, their money. Right. And I've known people who've been in their houses and seen the vaults and stuff they had now.
Okay.
They keep people from stealing their money or
sure.
going in there. You see, I hate to see Italian, but the European man was the same as bad here in Cleveland as it was in Chicago. Mafia and all that stuff, yeah.
Okay.
And they ruled with iron fist, you know. And then if they didn't like you, they shoot you.
Is that right?
Yeah. And that's it. And don't try to steal from them. They shoot your mama.
Whoa.
they don't care. But anyway, that was Cleveland's. Well, now, they took over the Cedar Avenue and the upper 90s and 100th Street, 105th Street and all that. All that was moving. And then over on East Boulevard, these great big houses, they call them Shakespearean Row. Mm-hmm. Those were all owned by racketeers. Black.
Black.
Mm, yeah.
Was Deering's?
Deering was one on
Deering's
Deering
was,
restaurants. And stuff.
Yes, mm-hmm. But he had number. He was number associated with numbers or just restaurants.
Both.
Ah.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
And
I used to know them all by name.
Scatters, you hear Scatters.
I went to school to pick up numbers, you know.
You did.
Mm-hmm.
And
Deering's. Did they come out of Pittsburgh?
I don't know. I may have made it. I didn't know that much about him. He was too big a shot for me to know anything about him. Just where street talk is, you know. But he was well liked. Well, everybody liked it if you got money. You know. So, and that was it.
Did they give their money back to the community? Did they help people in the community with their money?
Not that I know. Okay. No, they may have been. I would hope. To learn that they gave to the Phyllis Wheatley and the YMCA
yes.
and stuff like that.
Right.
It was so fine, but it didn't come into my area or knowledge or
right.
you know, stuff like that. But it was good days because Cedar was jumping. And then people come down off the hill and take over the black neighborhood on weekends.
Because it was happening down there. It was so
that's where the happenings were, right.
It was fun.
See, that's
it
was right.
Fun. And what took me about 105? Did that come in later?
105th Street runs through all of these, in and out, in and out, in and out, all the way out to Lakeside mm-hmm. or wherever it goes.
Mm-hmm.
The street, I mean, goes complete through.
Right.
Only one. 55th Street does that.
Yeah.
The 55th Street would go from south all the way up north.
So did people party on 55th too?
No, on 55th in Central, yeah. See, I'm in the middle of the black neighborhood. See, people come from New York to get to 55th in Central in Cleveland. Because they had the Majestic Hotel.
Was that, where is that?
Huh?
Where was that?
Back when I was a kid.
I mean, but where was it located?
On the corner of 55th and Cedar. 55th and Central.
Oh, people yeah. talk about that Majestic Hotel.
Yeah, well, see, they had
Billy Eckstein, they had
what they called a Rose Room. And the black bands would play there. Anytime you go to Rose Room, you're in big time. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you take the guy out to the Rose Room, man, they'll spend you some money, too. About $15, you know.
But that was a lot then.
Oh, yeah, a lot of money.
Wow.
Yeah. They used to have Benny Mason's Farmers right out here on Pettibone, out here now, on Pettibone is still there now. Mm-hmm. But then, they used to have Benny Mason's farm. He had horses you could ride, and a bar, and all that sort of stuff. And he had slot machines downstairs, nickel slot machines. That's the most I could afford. And I went out to town, and I played the slot machine. I only had about $3 with me, and lost it all and had to borrow money to get home.
Wow, at least in those days they would loan it to you.
Yeah, friends, you know.
Right, right.
Well, I didn't own a car then. I had to ride with somebody, and usually give them enough so they'd buy some gas. I was so broke, I didn't want the girl to know that I had lost all my money in the slot machine. A lot of money. It could have been $2, you know.
Right. That was a lot of money.
A lot of money. Oh.
Boy, so you all had some good times.
Oh, yeah.
So I want to bring you back now to...
I got a lot to tell you. You better move along.
I know. We're talking about high school at John Adams and your teacher. You said when he shared with you that your skills would come in later, you that was a turning point in your life.
Right.
That was...
Right, it was the first time that anybody outside of the family took the trouble to compliment me on something that I did. That means that you are worth something.
Yes.
I think that sounds pretty good.
Yes.
Because I knew it all along. In other words, that's what you call conceit.
Yes.
I've heard that word before.
Right, right.
Anyway, I like to go into the service.
Okay. We miss college.
Oh, okay, yeah. Okay, now.
Now, we might have to do this in two parts, but...
Yes. Okay, yeah. This is good. I was afraid this would happen.
Excuse me.
6 minutes.
Okay, we have 6 minutes to talk about college.
Okay.
Then we'll pause there.
Oh, it won't take long. Because, see, I've got a little job down on 27th Street in Payne. Mm-hmm. And I was a shipping clerk and porter. Porter means keep the place clean, mm-hmm. and shipping room, boxes and whatnot. And the owner, her name was Rose, I think her name. Anyway, he manufactured a medicine, Zemo it was called, for eczema. And you could buy it in a cream to rub on your skin, or a tonic that you can drink. And he manufactured that, and it was in his family. And he took a liking to me. And I started at Finn, and he picked up the tuition.
At Finn?
Mm-hmm.
And he picked up. So that's wonderful.
Yeah. And so whatever it was, and I went into business administration, mm-hmm. you see. And I was living on 80th Street in a rooming house. Her name was Miss Robinson, was the landlady. And I used to eat down the 79th and Cedar at the state restaurant.
I know.
And on a meal ticket. You buy it for $3 on Saturday, and you get it, every time you get a meal, you punch it. But dinner was 35 cents. Mm. 5 cents extra for pie, for dessert.
Wow. Know?
Then if you winked at the girl, she'll forget to punch it.
Oh, because you winked at her.
Yeah. Eat her up. But Miss Robinson allowed no food in her house, and you're not allowed to mess in the kitchen. All you get in here is your room and the use of the bathroom.
Okay.
And that was it.
Okay.
But it was nice living.
It was.
On 80th Street.
A lot of people.
Doctors and lawyers were living on those streets back then. And, I don't want to go too far. Anyway, I went up to New York one time. I had like a week vacation coming from a job or two or something. And I bought myself a cardboard suitcase that looked like leather, you know, and took off, rode me a train, got off, and I met a girl down at Wilberforce who lived in Camden, New Jersey. Mm-hmm. Something like that. Yeah, no. That was south, huh? Up north. Anyway, her family picked me up and took me up to the Y on 125th Street in Harlem.
In Harlem.
And dropped me off there and left me, and they went on back home. I haven't seen them since.
Isn't that
so? I stayed there and one I woke up and I had about 50 cents left. And my rent was up, paid. And so I decided I'd leave that next morning because I ain't got enough money to stay here. I went down to Union City, had about 50 cents. And I bought a chocolate Hershey bar for about 10 cents. That left me about 35 or 40. And when I got off of the train at the Pennsylvania Station.
Terminal Tower?
Huh?
Terminal Tower downtown? Terminal Tower?
No, 55th and Euclid.
Oh, 55th and Euclid, okay.
It used to be Pennsylvania Station there.
Okay.
And I had about 10 cents, and I walked over to Cedar, and got on and rode the Cedar car for 10 cents down to 79th Street, and walked home from there up 80th Street, broke.
But you got home.
I got home. I went upstairs, I emptied all the clothes in there were dirty, you know. And then I took the suitcase and walked back down 80th Street. Hey, Mr. Mackers, how you doing? Where you going to ask? I broke this thing. I got to see if I can get here and get it fixed because I borrowed it, you know. So I took it to the pawn shop and pawned it. And the man gave me $5 for my suitcase. And it was cardboard, you know.
So you were finished with your trip, you pawned your suitcase.
I got $5.
And you're back in business.
I went right next door to Pigfoot place. Greasy Pig, they call it. Went to Greasy's and got a Pigfoot, two big pig feet, and a plate of beans for a quarter.
Oh, right.
And I pigged out.
All right. You were back
then,
in business.
Then I started on back to New York. Here come New York.
Is that what they called you, New York?
No, I had a New York look and a New York walk.
Oh.
I was a bad motorcycle. I just threw that in there.
Those were the days. Those
were the days, that's true. Now, anyway, that's how the college started. And I said, back in, it's been, and it's in Finn Tower, and the Finn Tower is still there.
Mm-hmm.
And had a buddy that, and then we both did our homework and stuff. How's the time going?
10 minutes.
Good. And did together. And then one day, and this is absolutely true, I got sick of my life. I didn't like the way it was. Accounting was a piece of cake, no problem. I was doing that. All of the big double ledgers and all that sort of stuff. I learned how, you know, all that. And it was going fine. And on my way, but I wasn't happy because I would do the homework on the bed at home. I had those big ledgers all spread over looking for 10 cents, you know. And so I walked up Cedar to the draft office and asked her, how is my number stand with the ones they're calling? See, every day in the paper they'd put the numbers as next on the draft list because I had signed up for the draft.
And this is World War II?
World War II, right.
So they're drafting people.
Drafted. So I went in.
Here's the Kleenex right
there. Oh, okay. So I asked the girl, how far away am I away from being called?
Mm-hmm.
She said, oh, you got a nice little time. I've got 6 or 8 months or something like that. I said, well, suppose I don't want to wait that long. She said, I can get you out of here next week. I said, do it.
Okay, we're going to pause right there.
And I talked to the girl. Uh-huh. This may be on you. I asked her how soon would my number, because I took part of a national lottery.
Yes.
You know, that's for all young men, except if you've got money, you know, how that goes. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I can get you out of here in 10 days. I said, okay. I said, do it. So okay, sign this. I signed it. I said, now you are out of the draft now, and you are what is known as, we call them, a volunteer. Now you're not signing up as a enlister. You're not enlisting, but you're signing up as a volunteer, a V. And that gives you a different status, you see? I said, okay. And so you're not a draftee anymore. Bye-bye. Anyway, make long
So that was better?
Yeah, because it got me immediate attention.
Yeah, but do you get paid while you're in the service?
Oh, yeah, but that didn't affect your pay.
Okay.
You're still a private when you go in.
Okay.
Now, we'll go on this, and I'll tell you exactly what happened. So here I go. I'm the same Robert or Bob that I was the day before, only now I am going into the service, just like that. I packed up all my stuff, took it out Mount Pleasant, you gave it to my stepmother to keep for me, and I had drawings in there, and I had some art too. I forgot my art thing. I was good in watercolors and stuff, and I didn't like oils. Watercolors I could do, and it made sense. And you can be a little bit abstract with watercolors that you can't be with art, with oil.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and abstract flowers and roses with yellow and pink and stuff, and good scenes and stuff. And I had a whole stack of butter, and that was on display. Because
mm-hmm.
I had taken two majors in high school, in mm-hmm. Adams.
Majors, boy.
Yeah, and so and art was one of them. And I combined the art and the drafting.
Mm-hmm.
You kind of tie it together. Only one straight lines and the other is any. Mm-hmm. So.
Packed everything up, took it
to. Packed everything up, and it was had to report downtown on 6th Street somewhere at a certain time, and I was down there, right? With a suitcase, cardboard.
Not leather.
And joined the gang, got in line and all that sort of stuff. And I was like a whole new world is opening up, you know. I see, my boundaries are getting so I can't even see them. You know what I mean?
Wow.
Yeah, see? And I just felt different. See, I felt...
You weren't nervous?
Huh?
You weren't nervous?
No. I've always felt confident that if you're not an animal, I can deal with you, you know? So, as long as I got my big mouth, and I know if I can stay sharp up here, I got you. And you open your mouth, and I peg you right away.
Now, how many, you know, they said the service was segregated, so... When you volunteer, what does that mean? Did they put you in where everybody else is?
If you're black, yeah. But see, at that time at my age, I accepted all of that.
Right.
So it's no big deal, like I've been one place and I'm in somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
It's no different wherever I go.
Because
mm-hmm. it's all black, mm-hmm. you see. Mm-hmm. In fact, the people down in the recruiting office are all white. Sergeants and officers. I didn't know the difference between enlisted men and officers and all that.
Right.
All right, so now...
Did the war break out already?
Yeah, because it was in 40... I went in 42. War started... Pearl Harbor's 41.
Okay.
So is that about a year later, you see?
Okay.
And like I said, well, everybody my age stays on pins and needles because sooner or later you got to go.
Were you feeling?
You know you want to go.
Were you wanting to go to fight for your country? Was that the reason you wanted to go?
I wanted to go in number one because they feed you three times a day.
All right.
Good.
Okay.
Army will feed you, but now they say you take as much as you can eat on your plate and take it back to your table, but you got to eat everything you took back there with you.
Okay.
We don't throw away anything.
Okay.
We cook everything on a pig but the squeal.
Mm-hmm.
And so I look forward to that. See, I was eating in a restaurant down there at 79th and Cedar.
Mm-hmm.
and you can't take food home. It's rather than go through your drawers. And I have fried rice from a Chinese restaurant down way down the bottom of the drawer. You can smell that smell come up through the. And I know damn well she knew I had food down there. But I was, at night, you're in a rooming house. You get hungry. You're hungry.
Yeah.
And I used to stack up Hershey bars and Clark bars and stuff to eat because I wanted food. You see, I do that now. I get up in the middle of the night and go in an icebox. He's like,
right.
But anyway, back then, well, I got in the service, and I don't care what you're doing, come dinner time, you're going to eat.
Okay.
Out on the field, mm-hmm. in combat, anywhere else, dinner time, you eat.
Okay.
British soldiers are different. At tea time, they have tea.
Okay.
Twice a day.
Okay.
I went to school in London somewhere once. Mm-hmm. And even in Paris, I went to school. Tea, but all that later.
Okay.
Anyway. So I got in and I started mixing with the other guys, my peers or whatever.
All black unit.
Oh, yeah, all black. Everything's black. Okay. Everything's black. And we'll get into the black-white thing later on.
Mm-hmm.
And I was sitting on my luggage or something, and there was the guy come up, one of the white men come up and handed me a sheet of paper. I says, "Are you McMillan?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "This is the people in your group. This group is going to be leaving here in about an hour. If we'll call your number, because you're number 18, this group, and I'll show you where to go, because the trains were coming out, Camp Perry, right out here." And so I said, "Where are these people around here somewhere?" I says, "Okay." So then, I went to look back, and there was somebody sitting on my pack. I said, "Hey, pal, you're sitting on my leg." He looked at me, and I said, "Get off my damn bed, will you, man?" He got up, and I grabbed my window and walked on away. And so I said, "Man, he could have kicked my butt." I yelled at him. I said, "So what? That's my luggage. He don't know what he's sitting on." The whole thing started right there.
That was it. That was the beginning.
That was the beginning. Mm-hmm. And so I ran down, I had these guys tell me who they were, and they started calling me sir right away. "Yes, sir. No, sir. Your name is John, sir. Yes, sir." And I'm just like them, street clothes and all, you know. And I said, "Okay, I want you guys all stand around here, because when they call number 18, we got to go and board the train we're going to get on." Okay.
So you gathered all the guys that were on your list.
Put them right there.
All right.
And so.
So you were a leader.
Just like that. And I didn't know why it just happened, you see, because the man gave me the paper, you know. He gave me something to do. And I got his ass off my clothes he was sitting on, you know. And yeah, I got, "He didn't want to get up." I kicked your butt, "Bro, you better get your ass off my clothes." He got up. And I did.
You could have some. Go ahead.
And so, okay, then we started. We went to the service, and every time I turn around, they're asking me to do something. "Can you write?" "Yeah." "Can you type?" "Oh, yeah." "Yeah, you got it." "Yeah." And so, and then they had S3, each division of your unit had like a number. The quartermasters are like S4. S3 is engineering, S2 is intelligence, etc. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And I wandered back into their S3 and had a drawing board. "Hey, I like all that." So I got to tell him, one of the kids was drawing on there. I said, "Who does all this, you know?" And so the guy said, "Well, I do." I said, "It's nice looking stuff, yeah." He said, "You know anything about it?" I said, "Sure." He said, "I can do that." Yeah. I said, "Hmm." He said, "Well, ain't no jobs in here open." I said, "That's okay with me. I don't care. I'm in this new world, you know." "Hey, baby, you're not going to hurt me." And so, things were going, and I went out on all the field drills and on down in the mud and learned how to use a weapon and all that sort of stuff. And I liked it.
You liked it?
I liked it. I loved it. And I read everything I get my hands on. And so, I'll go back. I said last night I should do this. If you're not familiar with the structure of the army, first of all, you're going to start with an army. And the army is composed of various units. Army is the last designation of your entitled your whole life. Now, under the army come regiments.
Okay.
And under regimental, the regiment is about 1,500 people.
Mm-hmm.
They have battalions are next.
Okay.
And the battalions are made up of companies. Next one down. And the companies are made up of squads.
I didn't know this.
And all the way down to the enlisted men, see? So you go up. First of all, you're in a squad. Then you got a squad leader. And that's among the men themselves. Then a lieutenant has three squads. First, second, and third squad.
Ah.
See? And then the company has, the battalion has six companies. A, B, C, D, E, F. See? And F has three squads. See? All the way down to the last man. Now the second lieutenant's job is to be a squad leader. See? And then the captain's job is a company commander. That's the next back row. No, there's two lieutenants. Go, you got a roll bar, and you go from first, second lieutenant to first lieutenant. The roll bar is changed to a silver bar. The captain has two silver bars. The last rank I had, the word I was going to bring down and show is where I was promoted to captain. And it's a great big thing for the United States Army and all that. Officially Captain McMillan.
Hooray.
Mm-hmm. All right, now. So one day, and now I'm squeezing together. I stopped going out on the field building bridges and all that sort of stuff because there's always something for me to do inside.
At the drafting board?
No. Right up under the captain, the commander. I was his number one man. You see, and then now that. Not a lettered company, A, B, C, D, or E, or F, but headquarters company,
wow.
Which is above
all of them.
All of them. And in the headquarters company, headquarters company camera was a captain, and I was a second lieutenant. No, I was an enlisted man then, with no rank. Then they come to me and says, we've got an order from our regimental commander. We need a man to send to OCS.
What's OCS?
Huh?
OCS?
Yeah, Officer Candidate School.
Oh.
See, and so I heard about it and all that. And so, because that's like going to Jesus School, you know, or something. So, you know. Have you ever considered that? I says, I don't know. In other words, I'm happy like I am. What do you want? Anyway, so it'll be good for your career, beautiful for us to have you represent us. If you accept, there's only one application for the whole regiment.
Wow.
That's 1,600 people or something, man.
Yeah. Isn't that something?
Yeah. I said, you. And I said, and it's for the tank destroyer school. They started a new division. Rommel was kicking their butt down in Africa at that time.
In Africa?
Yeah.
Who was
Rommel? And the English general. General Rommel.
Okay.
And German. Rommel was the German. Mm-hmm. And we needed, because Rommel was running the desert. That's right. And they wanted to send Americans down there to combat Rommel, because Rommel was running everybody out. They invented a new tank destroyer. All they did was just take a modern tank and modify it, put bigger guns on it. And I said, that's a good way to get killed. Out there, they were shooting it. Once that tank started burning, you are fried chicken, kid. And you cannot get out, not in no hurry. So then I said, okay. And they said, on the 7th of January, you will leave the camp here and go to Texas. We had been down in Texas before, or I'm cutting it short. I said, okay. I said, man, I don't want to get in a fighting. I'm having too much fun out here. They come in here one day, woke me up about 4 o'clock in the morning, just go up to headquarters, and they said, you just got a telegram in from the division head. I forgot divisions. They need an engineer officer. There's an opening in Fort Belvoir, Virginia, officers' candidate school for a new division of black officers. We need one.
Whoa.
I said, would that interest you? I said, well, I'm an engineer. He said,
would you change?
I said, I'm an engineer. He said, you sure are? So now, what if we would change you from going to the tank destroyer school to the engineer school? I said, that's a deal. But he said, you're going to have to leave here on the 1st of December instead of the 7th, which still gave me about a month, you know. This was all back in December.
Mm-hmm.
And that started it.
And that was December 1943?
Two.
1942.
Mm-hmm.
So when you got in, you were moving.
Right.
You went in 42.
I didn't even have any rank.
You didn't have
any. So then they just said, well, ho, wait a minute. We're promoting this guy to go to OC. He don't even have a stripe on him.
So did they give you one, or did they just?
No, they went out and got one. I was sergeant. Overnight. He skipped the corporal and all that.
It made you a sergeant.
I was Sergeant McMillan. Overnight.
Isn't that something?
Mm-hmm.
It started in.
So that means when I get down to the officer school, I don't look like a rookie.
Yes.
I got something.
Yes.
Yeah. I said, man, hey, you know, I like this. And all of a sudden, like when the guy told me in high school about your future.
Yes.
And it came like it was natural. Yes. I said, that's not right. I ain't that smart. They think I am. That's because they're all dumb. That's why they think that. That's what they think. And they're showing you what they think. You know who they are, but they don't know that you know that what they are. Understand what I'm saying? I said, hey, run with it. And that's what I did.
Wow.
Left out of there, and they said, for sure, stay in touch with us to let us know your progress, because everybody here is pulling for you.
Wow.
I didn't know that. I did not know that.
So everybody in your squad?
No, other officers and whatnot, and the whole regiment knew that they had picked the guy out down there to go to engineering school, officer school.
Wow.
And who? The other McMillan guy. No, shit, you know. And all of a sudden, I'm a celebrity. No, no, so shit, I can eat this stuff up. I went down there and started kicking ass.
You were an engineer.
I was an engineer. Mm-hmm. Now, Fort Belvoir Engineering School is still there today. The number one officer candidate school in the whole country.
It is.
And all of your instructors are ex-West Point graduates.
And you didn't go but to John Adams.
That's right.
And that teacher told you you were going to be somebody and your skills would come into play one day.
I got hold of that manual. When you check into that school, if you got a mustache to make you get out of line and go shave it. You have no rank. You have no nothing. You are a cadet. You don't have any rank. And you got your name tag. It's your name spelled out right here. And each week they change the color of that so they can tell what year or what month in the process that you are. We got, instead of 3 months, it's 4 months. Because you had everything that we do has to be done in this school. And then they give you book upon manual, a manual of what you're going to go through while you are there. There will be no excuse for you not having your lesson because you got the plan with you right now.
Wow.
Yeah, that's up to you.
And you made up your mind that you were going to do it.
I jumped in them boots. Mm-hmm. That's right. And 3 or 4 times they called me up and thanked the good luck and the good Lord and all that. And I was ready for them. Ate them up.
Did you? So did you let the people back in your regiment know how you were doing?
I forgot all about them. I have to admit, yeah.
They followed you.
They followed me, they probably did, yeah. Mm-hmm. So then, we have an unusual way of, once a month, they give you a slip of paper with a roster printed on it, and you are supposed to put on that list who you think is the best soldier in your outfit by number to the last one. In other words, if John Jones is on the list and you think he's the best, you can put number one beside his name.
Okay.
Yeah? And then one guy don't show the other guy, you fold it up and you hand it back in.
Mm-hmm.
That's how they determine what you think of your own
peers.
People.
Mm-hmm.
You see? Good or bad.
Wow.
You see? And so I just put down what I thought down here. Not, I didn't put myself as number one, but I sure in the hell didn't go down to the bottom of the list. No, you can't put your own down
there. Oh, okay.
That's right. Everybody but you.
Okay.
You don't put your name on there at all.
Okay.
That's right. And finally, and so every now and then, one of them guys are coming, hey, Bob, yeah. Don't tell anybody if I put you up on top of my list. I said, well, thanks. I said, oh, man, you know you got it, man. I said, no. He said, okay, I just want to let you know. And now that, more than one come up to me and told me that. He said, put you on my list. I said, thanks. Yeah. I said, hey, this is pretty good. Yeah. I said, now then, you go back to the teacher. I said, you know.
You were a leader. So I when said, and so then, from where did you go from the engineering school?
I was assigned a unit that was getting ready to go to Europe.
Mm-hmm.
And I had brand new bars and everything, new uniform and all that, you know. And I was in like a whole new world. Everything began to change.
As an engineer in the service, when you went to Europe, what were your job responsibilities?
My MBA or whatever, MMBA, my engineering title would be engineering in bridge building.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Now we had to learn explosives, chemicals, wood construction, concrete construction, steel construction. I took to the Bailey Bridge, which is a British bridge, put together like the kids' toy erector set.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But it'll carry like a 10-ton truck if it's built right. Yeah, I loved it. And I knew the nomenclature of the bridge from a pivot to hold two pieces together to a screw that goes in a plank.
Mm.
And I had a test one day and I got 100% on it.
Wow.
About 115 or 20 pieces, yeah.
Bridges are very important today.
Mm-hmm. So I went to a British Royal Engineer School and they're
you're in England now.
In England then. To build Bailey Bridges, and I went to that school and I got a certificate of them. They're the British Royal Engineers, I'll have you understand.
My.
We drink tea twice a day.
You're not in a segregated unit still, are you?
No. Segregation, I was out. Truman did that.
Truman. Yeah. That's why I was going to ask you who was the president.
Truman.
He desegregated the service.
Mm-hmm. All the way. Black, white. Oh, okay. Only time we got in trouble. When he got to England, now I'm way ahead, you know. I'm a seasoned officer by now, yeah. They would go through England, and Wales is where we ended up staying. Oh, I'm going to tell you about the boat trip, too. And put all blacks in one town and all whites in another town. English people says, why do you do that? Well, back home, they said, well, you're not home.
Oh, the English said that?
Yeah, English says, you're not home. Right? You don't like the blacks, so you give them to us, that means you don't like us, right? They said, oh, no, that's not the point. Well, why do you separate them? They couldn't explain it to the English to their satisfaction.
So they
now, the white boys got the idea that they were superior. You get a bunch of those white soldiers together, you got to fight. When you see a fight, people, you get the hell out of there. officer ain't got no business getting involved in nothing like that, you know. No, you don't want that. Because you got to take a side. You're not allowed to take a side. Can't do it. The only way you can take a side, take your uniform off. Then you can fight anybody you want. Yeah. But don't fight in that uniform. Oh, baby. Because you're fighting the United States, not yourself. You're representing the United States. That's what they got all that stuff over there for. Anyway. That is.
So then, because the people, the townspeople in England spoke up and protested, did they integrate the units then?
No.
They stayed segregated.
All they did was explain to you, we don't like your country's policy, but you're welcome here anytime.
Oh, that's what the British told you.
They loved them. They loved them. That's right. They invite you to dinner. You walk in the bar. You can't buy a drink.
Really?
And that, I just had a good time. I learned how to do the polka over there, tango, all that stuff.
You had a ball.
I'm telling you. Then, finally ended up, I meant to tell you about D-Day and where I was.
Well, I want to hear, did you go to France first?
Yeah, I was getting ready to tell you. I was down on, down in Monmouth, England, which is on the channel. Seaport town. Pretty down and got movies and everything, waiting for D-Day. And then, I'll tell you this story. It's being taped, right?
Yes.
The night before D-Day, about 5 o'clock in the evening. Now, in Britain, the days are much longer than they are here. You know, we start getting dark about 6 here in the summertime. There is about 11 or 10 at night. Long day. One of those evenings, looked up in the sky, and from as far as you can see to your left, and if you're looking like west, because they're going east, a line of airplanes filled the sky, as far as you can see this way, as far as, and as it got darker, the navigation lights on the wingtips, red on one side and green on the other, made it look like a Christmas garland from that side of the horizon to this, going this way, which is east, to Europe. And then you can hear the roar from the engine.
They were going towards Europe?
With bombs.
From where?
From England.
Oh.
Oh, and see, we're right on the channel. See? Okay. Going overhead. Continuously. All night long, and in the morning they were still coming. And the sky over the eastern part, which is the east of west of France, was red from the bombs that they were dropping on any place they could find one to land. That was the beginning of D-Day. And we all started praying and got together because they said our time is getting short. And the next morning, they handed us a sheet of paper like this with a message from General Eisenhower to his soldiers. You're about to embark on a life-threatening mission for your country. Something, something else, and bless you, and Godspeed, General Dwight D. Everybody got one.
Whoa.
Yeah. You can see now, then we were so close that you could see him loading and getting the hell out of there, heading towards Europe. And we were still not on their list, you know. Then, next day, they started coming back with the wounded and the crippled and the dead, and unloading, clean the boat up, and put some more on and send them back across the water. And these airplanes, the reason they could keep up the continuum over was they would go over there, drop their bomb, come back home another way, change crews, rearm it, and get back up in the fly and take another trip over. That was the beginning. I said, I'll never in my life, I'll never forget that. I said, man, Everything was coming up. Now I'm getting excited. See, now, in my unit, on the headquarters company, my position for landing was right behind the captain. I was big time by then, Jim. Still a second lieutenant. It took them a year and a half to get me my first lieutenant, when a normal soldier coming out of West Point waits 2 or 3 months. Go from the second to first.
Wow.
It'd be a year and a half to get to my first lieutenant. I said, okay, that's the way you guys want to play ball. It's okay with me. And so we got to Europe. And, oh, man, I saw everything. The bridge was just full of dead people and wrecked jeeps and stuff like that. And then look at the people who had to go in there and clean that stuff up, you know. You go get bodies and body carry, and they put them back on the boat, send them back over. And they were fighting, and then we walking in mud and all the way. It was just something. And then the guys used to get mad because when the kids run up and start speaking to them in French, they said, I'm a grown man, and I don't even know what the little boy told him about. He made it. In other words, he's supposed to understand anything anybody said. But that's how you learn the difference. The little kids, but they learn English. It's quick, you know, kid. Hey, sorry, hi, Yank. Hey, you got chocolate? Yeah, I got chocolate. Give me candy. You know. Oh, the kids. It makes a big difference, you know. It was something. Anyway, come on out then, and finally saw Paris. Loved it. Oh, did I love that city. And that's the first time in my life. Oh, I'm glad I can tell you this. We were stationed right on the outskirts of town, like Ramble Park is, or Thistledown District. I can't remember the name of them, but it was closed for the season, so they bunked us there. You could get on a subway, they call it a metro, right outside of the racetrack and ride downtown. And right up in the car, they got a map for the whole city above your head over the seats. And where this, the route that this subway takes, the metro, or underground, or whatever you call it, all the way through town, middle of town, all that. And on Saturday, when I'm off, no duty, you can put a clean uniform, take a little knapsack, there's another name for it, and pack it full of underwear, chocolate bars, or everything else, and soap and water, prophylactics for encounters, and all this other stuff.
We'll keep going.
And get on the subway, not knowing where I was going, nor did I care.
Wow, you were an adventurous spirit.
But see, that's the first time in my life I was free. People spend all their lives looking for freedom. I had it. I had a pocket full of money. I had rank. I don't have to introduce myself. My rank introduces me. They know my rank. They respected it. Whoever. So I could look at the train, follow along, going on the map, according to the stops that come up, you look out the window, and decide to get off. And when I get off, at my leisure, at my pleasure, and start walking. Every time one of the Frenchmen come by, he says, hi, Yank. Good morning. I said, man, if this isn't freedom, I don't know what it is.
Wow.
I said, so then I just walk up and I see a cafe, and if I want a bite, walk on in.
Long way from the segregation of Alabama.
From all of this stuff. All of it is gone. See, and have a seat. What would you like to eat? What time is it, you know? How about a drink? They don't drink booze. It's either wine, red or white. It's either Vin Blanc, which is white, or Vin Rouge, which is red. You see? V-I-N.
Shoot. Wonderful time in your life.
Nice to God. And
how long did you stay in?
We stayed in Paris for almost a year.
So you were in the service how long?
4 years.
And when you got out, Was it war over? That's when you got out?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I didn't tell you all the love story, how I met my wife and all that. I skipped all over that. And while I was in OCS, she was in Washington working, and Emory, my buddy, who has passed by now, introduced me to her, because I think he was hitting on her, yeah. But anyway.
Leave that out.
Anyway, but that was never discussed anyway.
Okay.
But she's a pretty girl. And I asked her to marry me the first date we had.
What's her name?
Kurt, K-U-R-T.
Kurt.
Mm-hmm. Love of my life. And I think that I built myself up so much when I was selling myself that she could have been a little bit disappointed when she brought her to field. Because I couldn't back it up no kind of way. I had money in my pocket, but that comes from the service, you know. But she hang on there and put on a little weight, you know, all young women do. All pretty girls have their time, but it was a beautiful marriage. And she died.
And from that marriage you had how many children?
Two, Bob and Marcia. Mm-hmm. And that's that part of it, but it was her. Well, I had an opportunity. I could stay. She lived in Philadelphia. And she was working in Washington, D.C. Now, the people she was staying with in Washington, D.C. on 22nd Street, I think it was, they didn't even have toilets in their houses. They had an outside toilet where the subway in Washington, D.C. is now, used to be slums, black folks. As pretty as she was, and her outfit, you still got to go outside to go to the bathroom. And I said, this is ridiculous. And I'm Cleveland beats the hell out of this. And I don't care where you live in Cleveland, you got an inside toilet.
Mm-hmm.
And Washington, D.C. was is about as far south as you can get.
Mm.
In the daytime. Washington, D.C. at night, Cedar Avenue. Mm.
But no toilets, though. But you partied.
You partied. Washington, D.C. at night.
So,
and they got women from all over the country, because everybody go to Washington for a job in the government.
Mm-hmm.
Kansas, Oklahoma, you name it. And they would like to talk to a black person just to see where their tail is. Like, an English girl is wanting to see my tail, you know. They ain't got no tail. I'll show you what I got.
Okay, Papa.
Okay, enough of that. Okay, now, where am I now? Back home? No. Okay, finished the war. Mm-hmm. I was...
Tell me about the last day when you heard the war was over.
Oh.
Where were you that day?
Yeah, war in Europe, yeah. In camp. And there were stunting bombers. You really mind stunting? That's take that aircraft, turn it upside down, do circles and all that stuff.
They were happy.
Happy as they could be. With a bomber yet, not with no small fighter plane. The bombers, they were turning them upside down. Happy, happy, happy. Everybody was grinning. All you could drink was free. I don't care where it comes from.
The war was over.
And I was in Paris during that celebration. And I had a Jeep and a driver. Okay. And I was on the outskirts of town, and I'm trying to get into town so I could celebrate because they were dancing in the street. I said, this has got to be something I see. I got my driver, said, let's go. I put all my clothes in my little knapsack. We went down the road. They stand in the middle of the road with a bottle in one hand, a glass in the other, won't let you pass. Pour your drink and hand it in. I take it. A suit, and it says, pass. I got the pair of drunk like a bitch.
Celebrating,
I'm telling you.
The war is over.
The war is over.
What year was that?
Ooh, 44, I guess. 43.
45?
Now, my mind's...
Yeah.
Numbers I can't contain that quick, you know,
okay.
Or recall.
Okay.
But it was... And I found my bar, or my place where I used to live, in town. These people owned the establishment. A restaurant and bar, there's another word for it, but it means the same
mm-hmm.
thing. Yeah. And they were waiting for me. And we celebrated. I said, put the driver up and protect his Jeep. They pulled a Jeep inside the building and just turned him loose, you know.
Oh, boy. You all had a good time.
Oh, I'm telling you. And the people, they got little balconies for the apartments, you know. They come out and wave from up there, women, you know. Come on up! I said, well, we better not get up to you. They never will find you.
Mm-hmm. Now, did you meet your wife when you were still in the service?
I was in overseas when I met her.
When you were overseas. You came home and met her? Or you
No, I met her in Washington. She worked in Washington.
So?
I was in school. See, you had to be down there like a full month before you could get a pass to go to town.
Shipped out, okay.
Yeah, before, yeah, but, see, and so, and Emory introduced me to her. And I asked her that night, will she marry me? I said, I don't have much time, you know. Because I know as soon as I get out of school and graduate, they're going to ship me out of here somewhere. So I said, will you marry me? She said, well, I've never been proposed like that. We just met tonight. I said, the answer is yes or no. She said, of course. I said, well, that's it.
Is that right? So when you...
Somebody asked me, why would you do something like that? I said, I'll tell you what. From my beginning, back in elementary school, I always knew that one of these days I was going to marry a pretty girl. I finally met her. I'm not taking any chances she would get away. So if she said yes now, I said, I'm on my way.
Wow.
And that was it. Uh-huh.
So did you marry?
Yeah.
Right then?
Oh, no, right there.
When you got back?
When I got back. Right. Okay. Yeah. Back in Philadelphia, too.
Okay.
And that's when I had an opportunity to stay right there in Philadelphia and make my living, whatever I was going to do for them, and or go back to Cleveland where it would be easier because I know my way around. Mm-hmm. And that was the only reason I chose to come back to Cleveland instead of staying there. Now I wonder how I'd have made it had I stayed there, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then one guy who was one of my sergeants, daddy was a preacher, and we got his daddy to marry us.
Wow.
At his house.
Wow.
Uh-huh.
Who was that?
Pickleman was his name. Sergeant. Mm-hmm. Nice guy. Nice little guy. He's sergeant.
Mm-hmm.
And the down part of that story is years later, a couple of maybe, still a close friend, he left home and went home to get a beer or something. And come back, he got shot on the street at a random bullet and killed him. And Pickleton is going, that ain't that a bit. That's life. Yeah?
Can we fast forward to post-military now? You married?
Yep. You got time? How much?
What time is it?
Quarter to, I got 10-15 minutes, something okay. like that. My dinner's all right. I just got to go home and warm up.
Okay.
Yeah, and I got evening things going. Yeah,
okay.
15 minutes.
All right. So when you got back to Cleveland, I would like to know where you worked.
Well, I'll tell you what. I come back, and the first negative thing that happened when I got back, my dad wanted some of my money. And he and my new wife fell out right then and there. She said, you can't take any money. He said, I didn't ask you, young lady. When I want to ask you a question, I'll address you by your name. I'm talking to my son. That's the way my dad did business. And the ordinary fellows hadn't any sense, or she hadn't any sense, she shut up. She said, I don't want to hear all that. She says, all I know is I'm his wife. I'm entitled to at least half of whatever he's got. If you want to take some of that away, I would appreciate it if you would address both of us, so it will be a family matter.
That's what she told him.
That's what she told.
And you stood by her side?
He got some. I just reduced the amount to please her. Mm-hmm. But see, that was my dad. You know?
Yeah, you were torn. Your wife and
yeah,
your dad. He'd been your dad all your life. She was just new wife.
Yeah. And not only that, I came back, I had a German Mauser pistol, brand new. Never been cleaned up with the shipping grease and stuff that's on it. I cleaned it up. Oh yeah, I got I really shot at some guy downtown Paris in blackout. Everything was blackout at night. All lights were pointed down, you know, so they can't use it from the air. And I had a little hotel I used to go to for drinks and whatnot. And when you go in the door, you have two doors. One you open and stand in the vestibule, then you go in so the light don't shine outside. And I had been in there with a buddy on the way out, and there was a white guy there with an officer's raincoat on. It's like gray. And he rubbed against me so I could feel the gun. And started calling me a bunch of names, you know. And in this vestibule, was he, my buddy, and him, he was bigger than me and all that. He said, I'll shoot your ass and all that stuff, you know. Black this and all that. And I said to myself, just move away 6 minutes, I'll show you who won't shoot who. Because my little German pistol or something, it will bark at you, buddy. So he got through cussing me out, and I guess I'm not going to argue with him. He stepped out on the sidewalk and started walking and disappeared in the black to my right. I went out there and I said, bam, 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 clean that thing out. My brother said, oh, Bob, you're going to get us killed. I said, no, we're going home.
That was where, in Paris? Wow. Okay, can we come back to Cleveland now?
Okay. Anyway. So I had a tough time finding a job. I placed a lid on all that. Anyway. And then every time I go and sign an application to get a job, they always tell me overqualified for what we have there.
Back to America.
That's right.
This was in the 40s? In the 40s?
Yeah, 46, 7, 8, 9, mm-hmm. around in there, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so then I'll tell this story. I never told anybody this. They needed trainees to drive streetcars. Cleveland Transit. And so many people applied that they have it in two places, a high school out in Lakewood somewhere, and one over here like John Adams or something. And I think about 1,500 people applied. 700 over here, 750 over there. I finished in the top 5 out of 1,500 people. And it was so crowded up at the top that they had to split in one in like 10 seconds. In other words, you got 96.15 or 98.22 something in order to separate them. And my brother, Carl, was I was like number 5, and he was like number 65, and he was still in the first group. Mm. Isn't that something?
Wow.
So, streetcar, here we come. Yeah, that lasted a while, and that didn't end up too good. That's another whole chapter. I'll tell you about that. Anyway, so then, every time I go, I went all around town. If I go to a battery place and say, you're not big enough. We want you to weigh at least 175, 80 pounds and be at least 6 foot to pick up the battery and take it from here and put it over there. We tried you before, it didn't work out, so we apologize. If we ever have opening for somebody and a little better job, we'd like to hire you. I hear that all the time. I said, what is this rank against me now? See, all that wartime stuff, you know, show up. I'm back where I come from. But I'm like a fish out of water. Hmm. And so my brother worked at Warner & Swayze in the shipping department. And one day he said, why don't you come down to Warner & Swayze and get a job? You won't have to go way down in the flat somewhere running a screw machine and all that. And they were going home and I'm going to work. I said, well, that would be better. I said, tomorrow morning. He said, come on, just tell the guy in the personnel that you're my brother. Hmm. So the next day, mm-hmm. I came down Warren Street. I said, come on in. Sign me up. Who would you like to start? I said, how about Monday? He said, Monday. See you be here at 8 o'clock Monday morning.
And that's where you worked till you retired?
Mm-hmm. And I had 51, I guess. Yeah, 51.
Started at 51.
Started at 51, and of all places, put me as in gears. Love them. And that's another form of math. See? Mm-hmm. Combination, gear combinations, ratios, one to the other, you know. And the reason why you want one speed higher than the other. See, we made machines with big gearboxes on them. We had a gear transmission department. That's what I really wanted to be, to build the transmission. Because I know what happened at them. We had one machine numerically controlled, computer controlled. The big spindle on the inside turns at a speed of 4,000 RPMs a minute. And it turned other gears off of it. We motor hookup will turn and build up the size of the gears up to why a little turn, I mean a big turn up there makes the little turn go wild. A small turn down here makes a smaller turn on the bigger gear. They had it hooked up, so this big spindle up there turned 4,000
wow.
a minute and
4,000
RPM a minute. That mm-hmm. big baby was what? And you can hear your watch tick.
It was that quiet.
Those are the gears that I made, or I helped make, to turn those big guns. Now, there were some gears. Oof. Now, in 1963, I'm under that machine, and I loved that stuff. I'd come home just full of oil, because you use gear for cutting fluid to carry off the heat when you cut one piece of metal against another, you know. And my wife said, "You stink." That's because I got a pocket full of money, baby. Now, I come home and I don't stink. You got a problem.
Right. Now, you said that you, if I'm not mistaken, you mentioned something earlier about your father.
Oh!
In Tuskegee, Alabama.
Yeah, okay.
That
are you still, that are you same, taping it now?
Yes.
Okay.
Seeing that same machine?
Yeah.
You seen the same machine back then that you seen in the 60s, well, the 50s or whatever.
No, they were old, yeah. Old machine.
You seen that same machine sitting in the
Tuskegee? The one that's in the picture?
Yes.
No, that's a museum piece. By then, yeah. You see, back when my dad was in Tuskegee, and they had a little machine shop, the idea that turning machine is one piece of metal forming another. You get good hard steel here, you put a sharp end, you can cut something that's turning towards you, and you move in with a tool, you just peel it right off, just like it's paper. Mm. That's turning. Now, machines didn't have individual motors to start the turning motion.
Right, right.
They had overhead belts.
Uh-huh.
They had a drive shaft to run through the building, and a big belt comes all the way down to your machine. Then you had like a big oar that you pull the belt over, and it goes over to a different pulley.
Right.
Or take it off. So instead of turning, pressing a button and stopping the machine down, you just take this big stick and pull the pulley away from, and pull the belt away from your little pulley down here.
Mm-hmm.
They had those in Warner Fridge when I started in 1951. Overhead belt.
Mm.
Yeah. And I'll show you how far they were. Mm-hmm. Now the one in that picture that my dad saw was obviously run by an overhead belt.
Right.
Because it was old.
Yeah.
There's something else you're going to ask me about my dad, too. I don't know how
to work. What year did you retire? What year did you retire from Waters and Swayze?
In 82. And they gave me, I was going to tell you. In 1963, they came, like the guy did, when they wanted to send me into OCS, to sell that supervision to me at Waters Swayze.
Wow.
I said, and then I loved those machines. Mm-hmm.
But you left the machine and went to be in supervisor.
I took a cut and pay too, because no bonus. No
overtime.
Overtime and all that good stuff,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
But you made good money when you were at Warner Swayze, and you had your family. So where did you move to? Where did you buy a house? And
well, I bought the house in 60. So I had the house when I went to supervision. I went in supervision in 63. But I was still on the machine, on the floor.
And where was this house?
Park Heights, off of East Boulevard.
Yeah,
uh-huh.
Between East Boulevard, 102nd off of Kinsman.
104.
104,
ran into. 104-28. Mm-hmm.
So, tell me about your first car that you're telling
about
me that
1951 Ford. Uh-huh. It was so cheap. It was the last car I sold under $2,000 by Ford. And it was 1999. Didn't even have elbow rest. And then, you had to buy them and put them in yourself.
What color was it?
Blue, light blue.
Light blue.
Bird egg blue.
Yeah.
Big 8-cylinder engine and an automatic transmission. I have you in 1951. It tore that Pennsylvania Turnpike up. I was a driving program.
Now, you know, I think you mentioned to me about flying planes.
Yeah, I'm a pilot.
When did that come in?
In the 70s. Mm-hmm. A Mooney, my dentist, I played a lot of golf too, and did a lot of, giving a lot of money away at the racetrack. I forgot all that talk.
Okay.
But you had already retired though.
Yeah. No. Oh yeah, I did retire in 82.
Right.
But I was flying in the 70s. Mm-hmm. Yeah, see. And there we had like a 73 or something Mooney. M-O-O-N-E-Y. It's built just like a P-51 warplane. And it was built for speed. And it would do it. I've seen.
So what inspired you to, what made you?
I always wanted to fly. I always wanted to fly when I was a kid. I used to make model airplanes and stuff.
Uh-huh.
I knew all the aeronautical, whatever it is to get you in the air and all that. But it had a big engine in it, all kind of instruments. And I went to school. I hired an instructor.
You hired one?
Yeah, he's the FAA big shot out of Lakewood right now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he sent word one time to tell McMillan to get on over here. Because, see, I was the first person that anybody knew of who soloed the Mooney.
Wow.
Because it was so fast. Most pilots wouldn't touch it. I got Carla's husband is in air traffic
mm-hmm.
control.
Mm-hmm.
And he wanted me to go to Oshkosh, Michigan one year with the other controllers so I could get in and out easy because I got to have a pass because of the airplane show it is. And stay in a hotel where they stay, I turned down in Warrenburg. He gave me a t-shirt that said, "Friends, don't let friends fly Moonies." I wouldn't wear that t-shirt anywhere.
Wow.
Because I'm a Mooney, a Mooney driver.
Wow.
But I've seen 200 miles an hour. Easy, because
wow.
You redlined at 190-something,
wow.
And you exceed the red line a little bit, diving. And I was with my buddy one time, he's an ex-Army pilot too, and he took that thing through some sense. The people on the ground thought that was me, because I'm sitting in the left seat, and the instructor, sitting in the right seat, but he was doing the flying.
Wow.
And my heart come way up here, you know, and he was pulling out, you know. I said, oh man, I said, this is what you call living.
But
let me tell you about flying.
Now, hold on one second, because we got 1 minute. We got to wrap it up.
You're going to wrap it up?
We're going to wrap it up.
You take the last man to wrap it up.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll tell you when he stops. I'll tell you about flying. That's why I stopped flying.
Okay.
Okay. And see, I know we left out a lot, but I did my best.
We'll do it again.
Yeah, we'll do it again.
Okay.
But anyway.
Peter, we've enjoyed this time with you.
I enjoyed it because, see, those are the things that made me who I am today.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Because I just did just as well down in supervision, and they had to remind me that there's a different type going from the Army as a captain and as a supervisor. I says, I know. Because the Army don't have a union.
Ah.
You see?
And you have a union.
You see? And so my word is the law, but it's not in civilian life. He'll go back to his union committee man and say, Mr. McMillan told me to do so and so and so. He said, well, we just served you up. But the Army man says, so go back to do what he told you to do. Don't argue with me.
Mr. McMillan, you had a wonderful life. You've done a lot of good things. There's no complaints.
No, except this last thing I had. And now I'm almost back to where I started from.
Yes.
Because,
well, thank you so much. We're going to wrap this up on tape.
Okay.
And we want to just thank
Will I ever
you.
Get a chance to see some of this?
Oh, yes. We're going to give you copies.
Oh, man.
For your family. And your grandchildren will see this. And it's been a pleasure visiting with you. And we want to thank you for sharing your stories.
I've never told you about this morning.